So I guess we can move on to William Beelman, one of my
Okay.
favorites. Well, he is my
Yes.
favorite.
Yes, yes.
So he's another expert on OBEs and the astral plane, and he has had many of OBEs himself and has written several books on the subject. He's also conducted a survey on out-of-body experiences, which gathered over 16,000 responses. And so I just want to read like a few quotes from his
Yeah.
books. And well, the first one I read was, what was it? The first one, Adventures Beyond the Body, I think it was. That was a really good one. But anyway, this one's from his book, Adventures in the Afterlife. And he
Okay.
says, after almost a year, I was becoming frustrated by numerous failed attempts to gain full control when I finally discovered that I was making this entire process more involved than it needed to be. During an afternoon out-of-body experience, I spontaneously shouted, "Control now!" I immediately felt an enhancement of my analytical mind. I said, I stood by the foot of my bed. My vision improved, but remained slightly out of focus. So I shouted, "Clarity now!" My vision instantly snapped into focus. I felt a rush of energy and awareness flow through my body and mind. I was thrilled. For the first time, I felt in complete control. My entire self-awareness was present, and I actually felt more aware than in my normal physical state of consciousness. My thoughts were crystal clear and vibrantly alive, and I suddenly realized that the key to control was to simply demand, all these different commands he has of like demanding this now and this now and this now. And other people have found that to be very helpful too.
Very many, many people that's working for, and including myself.
Yeah.
Commanding, it goes along with intention, strong intention, and commanding it. Like, you don't ask, you don't
Right.
desire, you just say now.
And act as if it's already happened or it's gonna, I mean, so he from his book, The Secret of the Soul, he has this higher energy level technique, and he says, my favorite method to avoid astral entities, obstacles, or any fear-based manifestations is to completely remove myself from the environment. This is achieved by directing your awareness to a higher vibrational reality. I move inward now. This must be a focused demand for immediate action. I move higher now, or higher self now. Any command directed to a different location can be effective. I know somebody asked, or in one of the comments of
The
last show,
last,
like,
yeah, I
yeah,
think
how do
episode.
we avoid these entities that
Entities. Yeah, it's
can
interesting because I
manifest?
naturally would just kind of, I think, show love and compassion. And maybe that automatically made me vibrate higher. And maybe that's why they would back away naturally.
That's another method,
So, very
yeah.
interesting.
I've had something like that happen in one of my I don't know if it was an OBE or remote viewing. It was all kind of grayed, so I wasn't sure to call it an OBE, but this like big ogre pirate menacing figure came towards me. It was really big and bald, and he was like gonna grab me, and I just reached out and hugged him, and he just disappeared. So anyway, Buhlmann says says this is basic soul travel, lateral motion of consciousness in a structured consensus reality. You can use the energy signature of any familiar location as your target. The key is to completely focus, know, and flow. It's essential to lock your awareness into a specific energy environment or your perception will become unstable. This skill is critical when you're attempting multiple reality jumps. It's interesting.
No
Maybe to
and
jump.
flow. No, flow.
He says, also, all dimensions occupy the same time and space. They are separated by their individual frequency and resulting density. As we move in toward the energy source, each heaven becomes progressively more thought responsive. Multiple heavens exist within each dimension created by the group consciousness of the inhabitants. One thing I like about him and Keppel is they're talking about inward. Instead of everyone's like, oh, I want to go to a higher
Outward and
dimension, a higher level.
higher.
Higher, higher, higher. And I agree that I think it's more inward.
Inward might
But
be the highest level you can go to.
right. And so he says, the sooner we awaken to and experience in the interdimensional path within us, the sooner we will evolve beyond our animal bodies and embrace our unlimited abilities to fully experience our spiritual essence. Our spiritual growth and evolution are directly related to our ability to navigate the multidimensional path within us. He says everything seen and unseen is a form of energy, and there's no escaping the subtle energy creations of our own mind. We must conquer our personal addictions and attachments, for these are the anchors that hold us to the destiny of form and matter.
Interesting.
From his book, Adventures in the Afterlife, he says, it's important to learn how to consciously move and lock your awareness within any individual energy environment. You unknowingly did this when you entered the first non-physical reality immediately after your death. When you embraced this construct and accepted it as your own, you became one with it. In doing so, you unconsciously locked yourself in a structured consensus thought matrix created by a group of like-minded souls. Yes, all these things are your projections. Now you can see how easy it is for untrained souls to become completely trapped within their own thought forms. This is a common problem for billions of souls dwelling in the physical and astral projections. Few souls are aware of the creative power of their own thoughts. The self-created manifestations of forms make for convincing illusions in all dimensions. Many humans remain imprisoned in this labyrinth of the mind. He says many people are relieved and overjoyed to discover that they really do continue to exist after death, and as a result, gladly accept the first non-physical reality they experience as their new spiritual home. You know, the white light, anyone? That's what you know.
Exactly.
You see first is that white light. No.
We do run it. It seems like my from my reading and interviews, yeah, they run off with the first person who shows up or the
first guide,
sign of tunnel or
grandma.
Light or something. It's like, I don't know, we're easily distracted. And I actually am very distracted in the astral. I don't know if it's similar to afterlife experiences, but it takes this focusing. No, don't forget your goals and go back to focusing. And maybe that's what it's like when you cross over and you're just like, whoa, wow, what's this over here? What's this person over here? I'm going to follow them.
I'm sure it's full of wonder. So he goes on, he says, however, there's one very serious problem with this comforting scenario that few are aware of and no one addresses. You've just accepted and adapted to a thought consensus environment on the astral plane. You have just accepted a reflection of spirit instead of the true essence of it.
Yeah.
You have done what billions have done before you. You have merged your consciousness with a non-physical reality far from your true spiritual home. By doing so, you essentially guarantee the continuation of your form-based existence and your reincarnation. The end result is that most people accept the denser spiritual realities of the astral plane as their new home. They settle for and adapt to the physical-like areas of the astral plane because these environments are familiar and comfortable. Thus, they chain themselves to the astral realms of form and substance, and the ancient cycle of rebirth is maintained and assured.
Oh,
yeah,
that's very,
very
important.
Profound. One of my favorite quotes of his. Yeah, he says, to become an effective spiritual traveler, it's vital to develop your flexibility of consciousness. You must learn how to shift your state of awareness without becoming attached to the energies that dominate a given reality. He says, this is one of my favorite quotes. He says, I'm often asked what I will do when I take my final breath. This is a critically important question that too few people ask themselves these days.
Why aren't we talking about that all the time?
Yes.
Nobody talks about that.
Right, exactly. They want their I don't know, their next fix in this world. He says, my answer is this. I will demand to experience my higher self, my spiritual essence. I am not content to simply go to the light. I am not content to accept past acquaintances and comfortable surroundings as my new reality. In fact, I am not content to settle for any form-based reality as my spiritual home. I absolutely know there is so much more available beyond the realms of form. There exist dimensions of magnificent living light simply waiting for us. All we need to do is accept and awaken and accept their reality. Two powerful truths are apparent. First, all form is but a reflection of pure spirit. Second, we are not helpless victims of an external force that dictates or directs our reality in our lives. We are bestowed with the power of free will and the ability to take spiritual action. Why would you settle for a pale reflection of reality when the pure realms of spirit are always present?
And I like it.
I wholeheartedly agree with everything he said. Oh, just lost my microphone. Hang on.
Oh.
Technical difficulties.
Yeah,
we had a big one in the last show.
Yeah, William's got some profound stuff out there. I appreciate his work very much.
One thought I had from this section is about consensus realities. And
yeah,
I think that's another reason why I want to stay around. I don't want to stay around here, and I want to exit all these deceptive matrices or matrices. If it is a consensus reality and you don't agree with it, or it becomes hijacked by bad entities, then it becomes very difficult to change it. You know, you're just one little voice. You have to somehow convince all the others of the way you'd like it to be. And if you don't want suffering,
Very good
I mean,
point.
I would rather just exit the duality and go to non-duality and stay there, or create or choose another better ideal reality, which doesn't have the suffering and all the other atrocities that exist here, you know? I think
Very
that's
good
basically
point.
what William was trying to allude to also. He spoke at this Afterlife Awareness Conference in 2015, and he's come to the same conclusion, well, a similar conclusion that the
And you can still
Tibetan
find that
did.
online, right?
Oh, yeah. And that we manifest reality with our intention and could go beyond form and consensus realities by going to the clear light of the void. He said, we've lost a lot of the ancient traditions and knowledge, but one of the ones that I found that resonated with me, and I'm going to share this very quickly, was a Buddhist trend, the Buddhist approach. And I'm not a Buddhist, but I really appreciate the idea of how they handle death and their concept of the bardos and how your thoughts create your reality after death. And that resonated with me because I know it was true. So I did some study, quite a bit of study, and it's clear to me that the Buddhists had a very clear way of handling death that we have lost. When someone dies in Tibetan Buddhism, a monk or several monks will be next to the person dying, and they will chant for days and days next to the person that is about to make this great transition of consciousness that we call death. They
Not
will
for
chant,
days. Wow.
yes,
Maybe that's
yes,
what
yes.
hospice care should be doing. They
Yeah,
should be
exactly.
chanting.
No doubt. They will chant, go to the clear light of the void, go to the clear light of the void, go to the clear light of the void. They are instructing this person on their journey of consciousness to go beyond all form-based realities. Think of this for a moment. Nowhere do we teach this in our culture. We talk about surrounding yourself with love and going to the light, but they have a very enlightened approach to this, I find. Go beyond, go to the clear light of the void, which means go beyond all form-based realities, go beyond the bardos, go beyond the astral, what today we commonly refer to in metaphysical literature as the astral plane, and its various millions of consensus realities that exist. They instruct their loved ones to bypass all of the form-based realities that we take for granted as our heaven or home. He says, is it possible that we ask too little of ourselves? Is it possible we've lost some primary skills that are so important to our entire evolutionary process? And I think that's exactly what has happened. He said, we have the ability to do so much more than just provide comfort for our loved ones and provide a loving environment. That's all positive, but I think we can take it to another
And
level.
crossing their fingers where they go or something instead of
Yeah, he said there's no such thing as death. It's just a continuation. We take it all with us, our entire state of consciousness. And he said we shape and mold our reality and the ability to shape and mold the non-physical thought responsive universe that we enter into at the moment of our death. And he said this is what the Buddhists have been talking about for 1400 years, what the Tibetan Book of the Dead. It's all focused on this concept that the bardos or these non-physical consensus realities are thought responsive, and it's up to us to empower ourselves to take command of our state of consciousness and our reality, not only in this life, but in the afterlife as well. We are not the victims of death. We are the proactive creator of our reality. But this is only as powerful as you internalize it within yourself. If you feel at the moment of death that you're a victim and you must just follow whatever belief system that you've identified with, then that's truly what you are. But we're so much more than that. We have so much more capability if we exercise it. So
So
that's
is he,
William
does he
Dillon.
say actually go beyond the light as well? He says go to the clear light of the void. So he's meaning go beyond the light, don't
That's well,
even
that's well, I don't know
transcend
if
the
that's
light.
beyond the light. Like you don't go through the light to get to the other side kind of thing. You know what I mean? It's just
True.
the light is to me, that's, I'm not, this is not William Dillon speaking, this is just me, and I'm not sure what his answer to that would be, what that means. But to me, like that's like just light's part of the duality. Like there's light and there's dark, and like I'm thinking the clear light of the void is non-dualism. It's like,
Non-dual
well, yeah, so
reality.
when it's a clear light, it's not like an actual color of light. It's clarity is in empty, like an empty sky without any clouds. It's just unencumbered, it's free. And so this non-duality, the void basically
It's the
is
nothingness and
the nothingness, but
everythingness,
yet it's everything at once. It's both. It's not, it's
pregnant with
beyond
potential, as
duality.
you say, you've said, I think.
It's beyond the light, because the light's part of this duality, right? There's light and dark. I mean, although they're intertangled, they're part of each other. You can't really, it's misunderstood. We don't really understand what's beyond the light. What is darkness may just be other energy that we just can't perceive because we got just limited perception. You know what I mean? But,
Now, what I'm going to show you is a crude representation of something that's almost impossible to describe. If this was really the entire physical and non-physical universe, this grab, the physical world would be this big, and the non-physical would reach into eternity, just to put it in perspective. Here we are in the physical world. When people have OBEs, they enter often the parallel world and they see a reflection or the substructure. At death, what people often do is they enter into what is commonly today called the astral. I don't like the term, but it's stuck. It's the next major dimensional reality. At death, many people enter the astral. It is, and they enter into what I call consensus realities, realities created. Reality is created by collective thought by groups. And when you die, when any of us die, and we're reunited with our loved ones, what have we just done? You have just entered into another collective. And by accepting their presence, by reuniting with them, and it doesn't, I'm not speaking about good, bad, or indifferent. Just think about the logistics. You have entered this other non-physical reality, and you have accepted it as your own. In doing so, it has become yours. The problem is that the vast majority of humanity at death is only moving this far. They're moving a fraction into the vast spectrum of consciousness that is the universe. This is how far we're moving at death, when there's so much more available. And we do it because of lack of knowledge. The belief systems have not prepared us for this continuum of realities that exist, this spectrum that exists. And often we will settle for what appears first, or what is convenient or comfortable to us. Something to consider. Something to consider for now on. Because this is very important. What's the end result? We've moved this much into the universe at death. And for those who doubt my words, who say, oh no, Bill, your fault, this can't be right. Well, everybody goes to heaven. Heaven is, oh, it's just beyond our scope. If this is true, then why can thousands and thousands of psychics still have contact with loved ones? Why? Because they're standing next to you. They haven't went very far. If a psychic can still have contact with your loved ones, what does that say about it? It sure doesn't say that they've moved to the inner magnificent dwelling points beyond all physical reality, beyond all form-based reality. It's an indication of how close they really are. And they're close because they have accepted a false self-identity of themselves. As long as you believe that you are a human male or a human female, you will continue to enter a consensus reality that far into the universe that is inhabited by others that believe the same thing. This is why the exploration of consciousness is so important, whether it be through deep meditation or through OBEs, or it doesn't matter how you do it. Those of you that have practiced deep meditation know what it feels like when you begin to lose all association with your form. I've talked to many meditators. I've done presentations at meditation groups and societies and conferences. And they all agree to this. As we move inward, we lose our humanoid form. We become, for lack of a better word, pure conscious awareness, which is our natural state of being. But until we accept this, we will always, in a sense, condemn ourselves to the form-based realities. And I'm not the only one who says this. Throughout Buddhism, the entire process of Buddhism calls this journey of consciousness from the physical to the astral and then back to the physical. What is it called? Billions of Hindus and Buddhists call it the wheel. That's what we're doing. It's no one has a gun to our head in the non-physical realities. It's our own attachments that are driving us. It's our own flawed self-conception that's driving us back to a body. We have to always remember this. For us to become self-empowered, we have to begin to look at ourselves and our entire reality from an entirely different perspective. Forget about these belief systems that are now dominate our society. They're flawed. They're inhibiting our growth, our spiritual growth, our intellectual growth. What hinders the spiritual evolution of all of humanity? Flawed man-made beliefs and institutional indoctrination. It's everywhere. I'm not exempt. I was born and indoctrinated with the best of them. I know what that feels like. It takes courage to start to ask the tough questions, doesn't it? It takes courage to break free from belief systems that are so incredibly entrenched in our global societies. God knows we all have seen what can happen when these belief systems run amok, without going into detail. How incredibly evil they can become. We have all been the result of indoctrination. And it takes courage for us to face it and begin to really re-examine our own state of consciousness. It takes guts to do that. It takes guts to really examine yourself and go, why do I believe this? There's no evidence to support it. Just because my mother believed it doesn't mean I need to. It takes guts to break free from the consensus that is so domineering. What hinders us? A flawed physical self-concept. I've already covered that. As long as we believe that we are male and female humans, we have chained ourselves essentially to a reality that we will continue to carry on that energy form. We will continue to carry that false self-identity. We will also continue to accept the first physical-like reality we experience after death. Isn't this what people do? The Tibetan Book of the Dead talks about this in detail, about going beyond the illusions of form. They call it the illusions, the projections of form. This has been talked about for 1,000 years. But most of us in the West are so incredibly indoctrinated into our multiple belief systems, we still have a hard time breaking free. What also lacks, there is a lack of accurate knowledge about the afterlife. Unfortunately, we color it with our beliefs. We're wearing glasses, rose-colored glasses, when we look at reality, when we look at our beliefs. They are influencing us in many, many negative ways. Many, for especially the fear-based beliefs that are absolutely everywhere in our society. And of course, the absence of knowledge concerning our spiritual evolution through matter. We are powerful, spiritual, non-physical beings using biological vehicles for tools of our exploration and development. That's all they are, biological tools. To be truly prepared for our afterlife journey, it is essential that we become effective explorers of consciousness now. It's up to us. Us alone. We have to break free from the belief systems that dominate our society and our culture. I don't care how ingrained they are. Often the older they are, the more flawed they are. Because all belief, think, they're all made by man. Anything made by man is flawed. Anything made by man. And don't take my word for it. Become an explorer of consciousness yourself. And discover this for yourself. I don't expect anybody to even believe me. It's up to us individually. We have to have the courage to break free, to become truly open-minded. Everybody tells me, I've been around for a couple decades talking about out-of-body experiences and teaching different techniques. And everybody tells me they're open-minded. Everybody thinks, nobody thinks they're indoctrinated. But yet, when you begin to dig deep, you discover, yes, yes, I have been deeply influenced by these multiple layers of beliefs. Each belief that we hold is an anchor holding us to the density of matter and form. The reason that true spiritual growth is often a challenge is because we make it so. We make it so by what we choose to believe. I'm glad you mentioned that. The Monroe Institute has a wonderful program devoted to lucid dreaming, just to give them a little plug, that is available here. I cover lucid dreaming a little bit. I focus on self-initiated OBEs in my workshop. Lucid dreaming is another portal to these experiences. I feel they're just as valid and just as important. I think that we can take control in our lucid dream. I'm a lucid dreamer as well. I journal exhaustively on every experience I have. And a lucid dream is a very valid inner exploration of consciousness. And what it gets, to me, it gets interesting. We have the ability, and I write about this in my first book, Adventures Beyond the Body, that we can actually take a lucid dream, and I call it dream conversion, or the Buddhists call it dream awakening. We can take a lucid dream. What is a lucid dream first? A lucid dream is a dream where you have a percentage of conscious awareness is present. Let's be clear on what we're talking about here. A typical dream, it's like, you don't have any real knowledge or control of what's going on. And when you become lucid, you become aware of your environment. You begin to think a little more rationally about it. This is a very important stage or step in consciousness because you are bringing a portion of your conscious awareness into that experience. And when we do that, that's the opening of consciousness. That is the point where we can expand upon that. In other words, if you become lucid in a dream, you can also demand to experience, you could demand to experience this, your higher self. You could demand to have a fully conscious out-of-body experience. I've done this many times. I teach it. We can take a lucid dream and in the lucid dream state firmly, now I'm aware. Or awareness now. Awareness now. We can upgrade the lucidity or conscious awareness of that dream state and to the point where we are fully conscious and fully aware. That's what makes lucid dreaming so fun and so exciting, because the potential of it is unlimited. I feel it's a very important, let's just call it awareness step. And the Buddhists have been talking about this forever in their dream awakening that's been talked about in many books that are now bestsellers. So yes, I feel that lucid dreams are very important to our entire stage, but don't just settle for that. Take it another step is what I'm saying. Take that lucidity and push the limit. Always push it. Always push it. No matter how aware you are. The only thing that we take with us, and I like to say make this is an important point that I really haven't covered. What do we truly take with us? We only have one thing. We're so in our physical culture, we're so obsessed with these objects around us. You know, it's all meaningless junk. We only have one thing. That's our state of consciousness. Think of it. The only thing that we truly possess and we will take with us is our state of consciousness. It's the only thing that matters. Everything else is just a game. It's just junk along the way. When we die, nothing will come with us but our entire state of consciousness. This is why it's so important that we hone our ability to focus our conscious awareness through lucid dreams or a part of that aspect. You're aware in a dream. That's a wonderful step. Oh my God, I'm fully aware. It's exciting. Fully aware. But then take it even further. I want to be even more aware. Awareness now. Spiritual awareness. Use whatever term you want. Higher self awareness now. It doesn't matter what the terms are. It matters what your intention is, because intention drives consciousness. Intention is the driving force. And once we know that and we hone it, we can begin to focus on the one thing we possess, which is our state of consciousness, because it's the only thing we possess. So to not give it the attention it deserves is insanity. And that's the problem with humanity. They're so extremely focused on everything but this. They're focused on all the external trivia around them and all this stuff that is meaningless dribble, when the only thing that matters is developing your own state of consciousness to the most that you can achieve in this lifetime. Because it's all we have. Here are some of the things we've learned, and just a few of them. And we know this for a fact. Of course, we can continue to exist without our bodies. We do it every time we have whether it's near death or out of body experiences. But here's the interesting thing. It can be, we can enter and we can re-enter the physical body without death. Many people are still not aware of this. People connect, unfortunately, the term near death for 25 years got a lot of attention, and rightly so. I understand that. It's dramatic. People loved it. They loved the concept of it. It gives you that 4-minute glimpse of the afterlife for that very brief period of time. Now, time doesn't exist, but the point is it's generally a singular experience. Imagine the power of this if you can do this again and again and then begin to become an explorer of your own reality, of your own multidimensional space. During OBEs, we can exist for extended periods of time while separated from our body. I've done this and many others have for extended periods. I mean over an hour with no physical none. Many of these things I've kind of covered now. We now, of course, know that our body is a temporary vehicle. And that when we prolong our out-of-body state, our humanoid form begins to fade. Why? Because our humanoid bodies are just a temporary vehicle of consciousness. It's not what we are. Yes, it's important. I'm not saying it's not. Right now, they're important. Our vehicles are important. We're using them for transportation and for learning and everything else. But it doesn't mean you're limited to that. So that's why this self-empowerment, I find, is the keynote of self-initiated out-of-body experiences. But it's not for everybody. It takes some courage to do this. It takes some courage to break free from traditions. It takes courage to break free from the paradigms that are so well established in our culture and society. Many times people said, oh, that's just weird. I guess for you it's weird, that's fine. The point is that we have to make a choice. Here are some of the basic realities we've gained. I'm going to cover this very quickly. This we know. Once you leave your body, none of these things exist. And this is the most interesting. By the way, there's no air. People still talk about, I've read books already where people are breathing in the afterlife. I got news for you, there's no air. There's none of the things, there's no gravity even. There's no mass. You possess no mass. It's a consensus thought reality. Individual collectives, or what is now, or through thousands of years, been called heavens, they're collections. They are collectives of like-minded individuals that have molded a thought-responsive environment. the afterlife, the non-physical realities are amazingly thought responsive. They're all, to some degree, thought responsive. The physical world is thought responsive. It's just a slowed down reality. And there's a reason for that. It's almost like the playpen, where people can at least slows down the reaction time. But once you leave your body, you operated by a whole new rule. There's new rules here. There's a new state of being. All of this is absolutely true. And we live in a multidimensional universe. There's no decay. That's why the word paradise comes. I understand how many of the biblical texts talk about heaven and paradise. Compared to the physical world, it certainly is. Absolutely. There's no death. There's no molecular decay. There's no diseases. There's no war as we see it. There's no, a lot of the ills of humanity that have plagued humanity for thousands of years don't exist there. But there's still self limits. If you die, let's just get blunt, if you're an ignorant, self-centered person and you die, you don't become an angel. You continue the exact same, your state of consciousness goes intact. And a lot of people find, I don't know why this is so shocking to some people. I know you guys are no better, but I'm amazed sometimes that people still think everybody becomes like a little angel. And they're flighting around in the clouds or something. It's amazing. It's like, oh my God, you're kidding me. You know, it's hard to talk to people sometimes. There is no density. There's no air. There's no gravity. There's no matter. You live by another set of rules that are much more eloquent. You communicate in a much more eloquent. There's no air. You don't need vocal cords. You don't need ears. You don't need any of these things. But your self-concept follows through. When people die, they continue to hold the self-concept of themselves. That doesn't change. You bring your entire state of consciousness with you when you die. Good, bad, or indifferent. That's you. There. The same person, only you're vibrating differently and you're less dense. But other than that, it's the same you. And that's that's why we have to work on ourselves now. That's why it's so important to become multidimensional now. The skills that you learn and abilities you develop in this life carry onward with you. Highly, highly important. Whatever you've developed in this life goes with you, your entire state of consciousness. If you have learned the skills to become a multidimensional explorer of the universe, those skills would also go with you. You're no longer limited to a single consensus reality. Who's read my book, Adventures in the Afterlife? I detail this clearly in this book about how an individual dies, his entire state of consciousness, and then you have to be, there's schools available, yes, on the different dimensions where we start to learn things and develop our skills. But it's so important while in this body, this is so important in the densest aspect of the entire multidimensional universe. When the skills you learn now are so important because they will determine the freedom that you will have in the non-physical realities. I don't like the term afterlife particularly. It's just a continuation of life, as we all know. And we're all going to continue and we're all going to be learning and developing our ability to become multidimensional beings. I think that's essentially, people talk about angels, maybe that's what they are, multidimensional beings that can move between dimensions, all including the physical. Why not? Why would, there's no limits except what we hold in our mind. I think that's what they really are, if you want to. So, what have we learned? We have learned that the universe is multidimensional. That outer fringe, that dark, there's little circles, that shows your lives. And as we progress, and this is again, it's a one-dimensional, it's very difficult to convey something so amazingly wonderful on a flat piece of paper. I just try to give you an indication of what it is. Each person is entering the densest, the outer crust of the universe, gaining personal experience. The time it takes to evolve doesn't matter because we're immortal. It really sounds crazy, but it doesn't matter. We have choices to make. Some people choose to accelerate their learning. Some people choose to learn to become more multidimensional. And most people don't even know it exists. What's wild is that most people think they're playing two-dimensional chess, don't they? Earth, heaven. 7.5 billion people. The vast majority think they're playing a game of two-dimensional chess, and they're not. We're all playing multidimensional chess. And the only way you know that is to experience it for yourself, so you can obtain the skills necessary